Well, good morning and happy Sabbath again.
Good morning.
We have a nice sunny day today. Better than last Sabbath. We were raining, but it brought all the colors out. The grass is all turning green, and I see lots of leaves coming out this week. Isn't that wonderful?
Our pews sprouted too.
Yeah, our pews sprouted too. I'm happy to see some people here today. We're going to start, as usual, with songs of praise to our Savior and our God. I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at His right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take Him at His word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of Him to be my Savior. That He would leave His place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God He was, my God He is, my God He's always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me bring my strength, my solace from this spring. That He who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior. That He would leave His place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God He was, my God He is, my God He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior loves, Savior's always there for me. My God He was, my God He is, my God He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God He was, my God He is, my God He's always gonna be. I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at His right hand stands one who is my Savior. You know, a lot of times we want things to go our way, and sometimes they don't always go our way. But it's always a good reminder to remember that the Lord's ways are always higher than our ways. And when we surrender to Him, He's always going to make sure that it's His will that happens.
And then so often we try to put our own will in that way. But when we just take a step back and let the Lord take over, wonderful things happen.
Amen.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. As the heavens are higher, your thought ways are higher, and your thoughts are greater than mine. As the heavens are higher, your ways are higher, and your thoughts are greater than mine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. As the heavens are higher, your ways are higher, and your thoughts are greater than mine. As the heavens are higher, your ways are higher, and your thoughts are greater than mine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway, filled with thy spirit, till all can see Christ only always living in me. Christ only always living in me. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains.
My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King, Jesus. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Yes, He conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Amen. Let's bow our heads. Thank you, Heavenly Father, again for your Sabbath day that we can come together and worship you and learn about you and prepare our hearts and minds for your soon return. Mm-hmm. I ask again that you be with Pastor Pond today as he brings us this important message, mm-hmm. and that this service is a blessing to all those who are hearing it. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Christianity corrupted. I wonder what that means. I wonder if that applies to my life. Is my relationship with my Savior corrupted? Is it any way distorted? Has it been compromised? We recognize that the times in which we are living are really climactic. This is the age in which I think Christians from all eras look forward to. And Jesus said, One of the things he said was, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Well, let's get started and see where this goes today. Revelation 18 says, I saw another angel come down from heaven having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen. It's fallen because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. And I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast, which was full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And on her forehead a name was written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, mother of harlots and the abominations of the earth. To underscore the religious nature of this Babylon, Jesus gave two metaphors. One was the metaphor of the ancient city of Babylon, and the other of a woman. Now, the woman, of course, in Revelation, in the Bible, represents a church, God's people. Ezekiel. Yeah, Ezekiel chapter 16. You have to excuse me today because I was not prepared to present this talk from my notes, but from the computer, but we couldn't get it to work properly today, so you just have to excuse me a little bit here. God accuses his people of being harlots by forsaking him to worship idols. Again, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations, and say, Thus saith the Lord unto Jerusalem, But thou didst trust in thine own beauty, and platest the harlot because of thy renown. God is accusing his people of playing the harlot because they were worshiping other idols. They were not being faithful to the Lord of God of heaven. And James says, he identifies as adulterers and adulteresses those who establish friendships with the world, which is enmity with God. So this woman that had the name Babylon, mother of harlots, she's not only a harlot herself, but has birthed others like herself. She has forsaken the true worship of Jehovah and caused others to do the same. They're all corrupt. I think that by and large, people are not aware that Babylon in Revelation refers actually to God's people. People who call Christ Lord, people who call themselves Christians, they're classed all together in a group called Babylon, in a city called Babylon, represented by a woman. By the 4th century, that's a long time ago, the Christian church had established itself as the official faith of the Roman Empire through a successful grassroots campaign to dominate and almost exterminate paganism. But did it? Not quite. In reality, the early church had to merge itself with pagan practices and beliefs in order to blend into Roman society. They didn't have to do that. But in order to blend into Roman society, that's what they had to do. Ever try being a genuine Christian in the world today? You're going to stand out like a sore thumb. If you want to blend in to society, then you're going to have to adopt characteristics of society. I remember that very well. I grew up here in Nelson. I walked a mile and a half from 1013 Falls Street to L.V. Rogers High School. And as I walked that distance, I joined with friends. And as we walked along, we talked. And their language, of course, was not my language. And I stood out like a sore thumb. During the Catholic Mass, for instance, bread and wine are transformed into the flesh and blood of Jesus Christ, who was considered the Son of God in a rite called transubstantiation. Now, this is not, and I emphasize, it's not a symbolic transformation. A core teaching of the Catholic faith is the belief that in literal transubstantiation, that means that that bread literally becomes the body of Christ. They're actually eating the flesh of Christ. And the wine that they drink is actually the blood of Christ. That's pagan. Practitioners eat the body and drink the blood of Christ to become one with God. During Catholic Mass, I think I already read that. Similar rituals were practiced in the underground mystery religions of the Greco-Roman world. In a few of those occult religions, celebrants shared a communal meal in which they symbolically feasted on the flesh and got drunk on the blood of their god. For example, Mithraic mysteries, or Mithraism, was a mystery cult practiced in the Roman Empire in 300 BC, in which followers worshipped the Indo-Iranian deity Mithraim, the god of friendship. And that's what they did. Also, a number of Catholic holidays and myths parallel the timeline and adopt the symbols of pre-Christian fertility festivals. In Catholicism, Jesus Christ is thought to have been born on December 25, Christmas Day. In pre-Christian Roman religions, the winter solstice was a core sacred event that took place on December 25. At the time of the Julian calendar. The best known custom, though, was the Roman festival of Saturnalia, which was celebrated similar to Christmas with drinking, fires, gift giving, and tree worship. Okay, winter solstice there, December 25, and Saturnalia, celebrated in a way similar that many people celebrate Christmas. Similarly, the Catholic Fat Tuesday, or Mardi Gras, is rooted in the pre-Christian Roman celebration of Lupercalia, a February holiday honoring the Roman god of fertility. Its customs involve feasting, drinking, and, quotes, carnal behavior. Today, the same can be said of Mardi Gras, when Catholics, as well as non-Catholics, eat festival foods and party before abstaining for 40 days during Lent. Though theoretically monotheistic, that means worshiping one God, The Catholic practice of praying to saints has been called de facto idolatry, and even a relic of goddess worship. Rebranded pagan goddesses can be found in the Catholic Church today in the forms of Saint Brigid and the Virgin Mary. Mary, the Virgin Mother of Christ, is arguably the most important Catholic icon, save the Holy Trinity. She's likely the amalgamation of pre-Christian mother goddesses from antiquity. And the cult of the Egyptian goddess Isis may have been a particularly strong influence on Christian myth. While historical records cannot substantiate this entirely, there is physical evidence of statues of Isis cradling Horus that were converted and reused as the Virgin Mary holding Jesus. Same idol. Today, millions of Catholics eating the body and drinking the blood of their God in the Eucharist, celebrated in the Mass, bowing their heads to feminine idols as the Virgin Mary, and celebrating natural cycles on the liturgical calendar like Christmas, Easter, Mardi Gras, and Halloween, are still worshiping in the ways of the ancient pagans. Paganism has corrupted Christianity. Besides objects such as the personal crucifix and saints' medallions, they're nothing more than Christianized versions of amulets. Having origins in pagan magic and sorcery, which creates questions as to how many Christian practices and objects emerge from these origins, even though the source of power of these objects was believed to originate from God and his saints, rather than from nature or pagan gods. Although most of these pagan practices found today in Roman Catholic worship have not managed to survive the Reformation, a couple of fundamental falsehoods have. Her daughters, by and large, accept the first day of the week as the day of rest and worship instead of the seventh. And they believe that there is an afterlife, including an ever-burning hell for unbelievers. And further, as men's hearts begin failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, Protestants, the lamb-like beast of Revelation 13, will follow in the footsteps of Rome. The daughters will act like their mother in using the strong arm of the law to enforce their dogmas. That's what we see happening in the near future. And as spiritualism invades the churches, the door is open to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, and thus the influence of evil angels will be felt in the churches. Corruption, it looks like, is increasing in Christianity. And therefore, the mighty voice crying, "Get out of Babylon. You're on Satan's enchanted ground. You're about to be seduced into believing doctrines of devils. Her sins have reached unto heaven. Her cup of guilt is full, and God hath remembered her iniquities. She's about to be destroyed." You may remember the story of Lot and his family who were in the city of Sodom. God saw the wickedness in Sodom and decided that he would destroy it. So he sent a message, "Come out, get out of Sodom. Come on, get out." That's a parallel message for us today. If we find ourselves involved in Christianity that's been corrupted, we need to get out. The command to get out of Babylon, combined with the warning, this is probably the most drastic warning that you ever find in the Bible. "If anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark in his forehead or in his hand, He himself shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. That is heaven's last appeal. So come on out of Babylon. Don't worship the beast and his image. That's the message we have for today. So here's what's coming. We could see a little glimpse of the possibility of that with the COVID regulations. I mean, non-compliance to those wearing a mask or the prohibition against gatherings. If you violated those prohibitions, you got some penalties. And we see in line down the future that it's going to be a parallel thing with regards to a day of worship. So here's the deal. The Roman Catholic Church teaches that it has the authority to change God's moral law, the Ten Commandments. Protestant churches, although not necessarily willing to grant her that right, still follow her lead in honoring the Sunday instead of Jehovah's Day of Rest. So, in recent years, the Pope, who is recognized actually as the world's greatest moral leader, actually he was identified as that by, you would maybe not guess that, but that was a Russian president said that, of, I think, Pope John Paul II actually. He's agitating for Sunday as a world day of rest, and not really on religious grounds at this point, but simply to reduce environmental pollution and make our world more livable for everybody. Protestant churches are joining in, lobbying governments to enact Sunday legislation, and some have already complied, and probably the rest will in short order. At first, the Sunday rest day will be supplementary for those who observe God's rest day. God's rest day, you know, was established at creation. And interestingly, when Jesus came, he said the Sabbath was made for man. And you know why the Sabbath is made for man? Because man and all living creatures, even plants, work on a seven-day biorhythm. And it has been demonstrated that if you take one day off, you will get more done in 6 days than if you try and work 7 days in a row, because our bodies work on a seven-day biorhythm. So why not take God's day? You know, I mean, he set it up. It was his idea in the beginning. It is the seventh day, not the first, that God has mandated as the weekly day of rest. However, taking a second rest day is no big deal. In fact, it may help produce the intended ecological benefits. You know, it might help. And perhaps even be a factor in the reduction of mental illnesses caused by stresses and pressures of our technological lifestyle. There could be a lot of benefits to having a second rest day. Besides, by forcing Sabbath keepers to rest another day, it gives us an opportunity to spend that time in serving others and sharing faith that we have in Jesus. We have special truth for this time, you know. We have an obligation to get this warning out to people to come out of Babylon. Christ is coming soon. We are on Satan's slippery ground, sliding towards destruction. The brief age of personal freedom is closing. That's a sad, sad commentary on what's happening. For those of us who have grown up in a land of freedom, it's going to be quite a change. For Sabbath-keeping Christians, the big crunch will come when legislation mandates I guess, no gathering besides on Sunday. I don't know if it's going to be a mandated, I don't think they can mandate a 6-day work week with a day of rest on Sunday, but apparently there's going to come a time in which there's going to be Sunday worship was going to be mandated. And it doesn't even seem like a possibility at this point, but I think we can see a little bit, like I said, from COVID-19 legislation, I can see a little bit of that on the horizon as well. So here's a kind of a timeline, a trajectory, a path. So now there's a stealthy but rapid growth in papal power. I don't know, you may not follow that too closely, but and I won't take time right now to talk about how the papacy has increased power and influence in so many areas of society, in Western society particularly. And there's, at the same time, there is an inroads of spiritualism, growing spiritualism within the Christian churches. And Sunday legislation looms on the horizon. I've just talked about that. And the reason for that is we need to return to God and we need to save our planet. There's an increase in frequency and severity of natural disasters. Even just taking earthquakes alone. If you look at a chart of earthquakes over the last 200-300 years, you'll see that they were at a kind of a steady pace, steady frequency over these many years. And then all of a sudden, in about the late 1700s, early 1800s, just gone like this. Graph has just gone straight up. Not just earthquakes, pestilence, famine, disease, violence, crime, all those things are increasing. Here's an interesting one. A false return of Christ. The scripture says that God's true people are going to look up and say, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him." We have waited for him. We didn't get sucked into that first Christ that came along. We waited for him. And he will save us. And so we're looking for the return of a false Christ. Or a false return. Maybe it should have been a return of a false Christ. I think that would be more accurate. And I think that, and we know that many religions are looking for a Messiah or a guru to return. Civil penalties for religious offenses. When we were in Morocco, we saw that in actual practice. During Ramadan, the religious policemen were out there making sure you did not eat during the day. Whatever other offenses there might be in Ramadan, the religious policemen were there. So civil penalties for religious offenses. We're going to be losing our freedoms, and we're going to be facing some of these ourselves. Sabbath gatherings prohibited. I'm not sure how that's going to come about, but apparently it's got to come about because Scripture is very clear that anybody who does not worship the beast and his image is going to have be slated for death. That's a loss of liberty of conscience. Okay, and then of course the mark of the beast comes with the seal of God when God's law is under, when you're prohibited to keep God's law as he wrote it out. That at that point, people will receive the mark of the beast or the seal of God. And economic sanctions, cannot buy or sell unless you have that mark. The death decree for those who disobey. So it's the time to wake up. When the Sabbath Sunday issue shall be so clearly brought into focus, Whoever shall choose to comply with civil law rather than God's law, and that's what the Bible calls worship. You comply with the law of the beast, you worship the beast. You comply with the law of God, you worship God. They receive a mark of the beast, the sign of allegiance to the prince of this world. And you know what? That's a bad place to be. The warning from heaven is, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. I don't think we want that. Yeah, worshippers of the beast, the number of his name, and so on. But no one is made to suffer the wrath of God until the truth has been brought home to his mind and conscience and has been rejected. There are many who have never had an opportunity to hear the special truths for this time. Obligation of the fourth commandment has never been set before them in the true light. He who reads every heart and tries every motive will leave none who desire a knowledge of the truth to be deceived as to the issues of the controversy. The decree is not to be urged upon the people blindly. Everyone is to have sufficient light to make a decision intelligently. And in today's society, with so much misinformation out there, you know, it's a challenge to have everybody understand what the issue really is. The Sabbath will be a great test. A test of loyalty. For it is the point of truth especially controverted. When the final test shall be brought upon man, then the line of distinction will be drawn between those who serve God and those who serve him not. Will the observance of the false Sabbath in compliance with the law of the state, contrary to the fourth commandment, will be an avowal of allegiance to a power that is in opposition to God? The keeping of the true Sabbath and obedience to God's law is an evidence of loyalty to the Creator. While one class, by accepting the sign of submission to earthly powers, receives the mark of the beast, the other, choosing the token of allegiance to divine authority, receives the seal of God. I think I'm one slide behind. Conscientious obedience to the word of God will be treated as rebellion. The words of Paul will be literally fulfilled. All that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Let me just check and see where I'm at. Yeah, I'm way behind. There's Sunday, and when you comply with the laws of the state, and if you go against the laws of the state, the seal of God. So there we are. All that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Interesting, isn't it, that this text comes up? Because in a few minutes we're going downstairs and we're going to open God's Word and we're going to study a little bit about the early church and the persecution that they suffered. To human wisdom, all this now seems pretty impossible. But as the restraining spirit of God shall be withdrawn from men, and they shall be under the control of Satan, who hates the divine precepts, there will be some strange developments. The heart can be very cruel when God's fear and love are removed. The Lord commands his servants to present the last invitation of mercy to the world. That's our job. We cannot remain silent except at the peril of our souls. Christ's ambassadors have nothing to do with the consequences. We must perform our duty and leave the results to God. No man can serve God without enlisting against himself the opposition of the hosts of darkness. I know that Running Wolf has mentioned that to me many times. When you put on God's armor and you start going against the powers of darkness, you're labeled. You got a target on you, and the devil's after you. Evil angels and evil men unite in seeking to separate that one from God, even trying to force the conscience. Persecution in varied forms is the development of a principle which will exist as long as Satan exists and Christianity has vital power. But so long as Jesus remains man's intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary, the restraining influence of the Holy Spirit is felt by rulers and people. It still controls, to some extent, the laws of the land. It's during this time, while probation lingers, that the angel of Revelation 18, who unites in the proclamation of the third angel's message in Revelation 14, is to enlighten the whole earth with his glory. The everlasting gospel goes to the whole world in a blaze of power. There it is. That's the angel uniting with the three angels in Revelation 14. And we trust that we can be part of that end time message. The work will be similar to that day of Pentecost, as the former rain was given in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at the opening of the gospel to cause the upspringing of the precious seed, so the latter rain will be given at its close for its ripening and the harvest. In the last days, saith God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and it shall come to pass that whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The great work of the gospel is not to close with less manifestation of the power of God than marked its beginning. Servants of God with their faces lighted up and shining with holy consecration will hasten from place to place to proclaim the message from heaven. By thousands of voices all over the earth, the warning will be given, miracles will be wrought, the sick will be healed, and signs and wonders will follow the believers. Satan also works with lying wonders, even bringing down fire from heaven in the sight of men. See, I didn't have all these marked properly. The seed has been sown, and now it will spring up and bear fruit. Publications distributed have exerted their influence. Now the rays of light penetrate everywhere. The truth is seen in its clearness, and the honest children of God sever the bands which have held them. Family connections, church relations, they're powerless to stay them now. Truth is more precious than all besides, notwithstanding the agencies combined against the truth. A large number take their stand upon the Lord's side. In the meantime, we have a work to do. We have a battle to fight. Ellen White has said, it's the greatest battle ever fought. The warfare against Uno. Number one, the yielding of self, the surrendering all to the will of God requires a struggle, but the soul must submit to God before it can be renewed in holiness. Yeah, we experience that right here in our church. This church is a place to prepare us not only for the trouble that's coming down the pipe, but for our eternal home. You ever get hurt in a church? Does it happen? Yeah, it happens. Do you ever feel like running away? I have. Ever feel like, I don't need this. I'm treated better in the world than in the church. I have. What's the point? What's the point of hanging in here? The point is that God is using this friction to knock off the corners, to mold us and fashion us in His likeness. Years ago, because I've been in church all my life, I am now, how old am I now? 81? I think I'll be 82 this year. Am I? Yeah. Anyhow, lost track of time. Several years ago, I had an insight. Because Moses had a problem with people. For 40 years, he tried to lead his sheep through the wilderness under extremely hard conditions. They were not compliant. They were a rebellious, stiff-necked group. They did not like their leader. They wanted to stone him. And when God said to them, you know what, I'm fed up with those guys. Just get out of my way, and I'm going to destroy them, and I will make of you a great nation. He said, no, don't do that. Take my life first, but save those people. Could I say that about my church? Could you say that about this church? Scripture says that Moses was meek above all men. Jesus said, the meek shall inherit the earth. Bingo. Put all that together, and it dawned on me. Jesus never meant the church to be a hurtful place. But if we, by faith, humble ourselves and treat one another better than ourselves, even those that mistreat us, follow the example of Jesus. When he was reviled, he reviled not again. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter. So, we can talk about Bible prophecy, and we can look at the future, and we can try and predict what's going to happen and how things are going to play out. And we can try and prepare ourselves for that time. But the best preparation is a preparation that happens right in here. It's winning that battle. The greatest battle ever fought. The battle to not respond in kind. When you are mistreated, a soft answer turns away wrath. The way we respond is up to us. Nobody makes us do the things we do, think the things we think, say the things we say. They're our own choice. And you can't even say, you know what? The devil made me do it. It's all your choice. And we need to own that. So I pray that in our lives, day by day, we may fight the good fight of faith, take ourselves down a notch, and just keep looking to Jesus. You know what? We need to take our value from Him. He created us in His image, after His likeness. We are His children. And when I start taking my value from you, what you say to me and how you treat me, I take my value from you, I'm taking it from the wrong place. I need to take my value from Jesus. I take from Him, He has all the resources of eternity to give to me if I ask Him. And then I can give to you loving kindness, patience, gentleness. I can give you the fruits of the Spirit that I receive from Him. But if I'm taken from you, man, I don't have anything to give back to you except the same kind of junk. So it's, you know, it's easy to maybe to focus on the future and focus on Bible prophecy and focus on some theoretical stuff. But when the rubber meets the road, when my life interacts with your life, and I don't relate to you in a Christ-like way, I'm not winning that battle. I just pray that you will have faith to step forward and to live your life. Live the life that Christ gives you day by day. Amen. All right, that's it. And now is the time that we can go downstairs and open up our Bibles and study about the great controversy.